Well, it's just my pleasure to welcome you to the second in our series of lectures that are a whole part of this series called Burlington Geographic. And my name is Walter Pohlman, and I'm just going to be giving the introduction tonight because I'm really excited about this program that you're out here to participate in tonight called the Urban Wilds of the Queen City. And more about that in just a second. But I especially want to welcome everybody to Burlington High School. Is this anybody's first time at Burlington High School? Look at that, most of the audience. This is great. This is great. I have a real affinity for the high school. I teach up at UVM. I'm the director of the PLACE program, and I'm an ecologist in the Rubenstein School of Environment and Natural Resources. But whenever I can, whatever communities I'm working in, I always try to partner with high schools. And my friend Peter, can you raise your hand? Peter McConville in the back row is really just a superior educator, and he does great work with his students at the high school and with the faculty here around sustainability education. And so we try to partner whenever we can up at UVM and have our students mix together. I'm particularly glad to be here tonight because this I consider this sort of the epicenter of Burlington right here. And I think of it that way, almost like a watershed, because every morning kids flow from across the city, all corners of the city, and they end up at this place right now. So it's a kid shed of sorts, and so if you want to try to, you know, get the pulse of the city and get the diversity of the city and ideas, it's happening right here. So we're really just honored to have be hosted here tonight by the high school as a part of this series. In fact, they're a partner in the whole Burlington Geographic program. And so just briefly, I wanted to, if you didn't get to come out the other night, we started this series at City Hall on the 19th of September, and with a program called Burlington Underfoot, and we were learning about geology and the mysterious ravine that runs diagonally across the city, really setting the stage for really all the drama that's played out for thousands of years in Burlington. And you're going to be hearing a lot more about that tonight. So Burlington Geographic is a program of the PLACE program, and that stands for, I mean, obviously it's a word that's very rich, but it's an acronym that stands for Place-Based Landscape Analysis and Community Engagement. And as an ecologist, that's what I'm particularly interested in. Many of our students and folks from UVM and many community members are very interested in sort of analyzing this place, understanding it, participating in it. And so it stands for that. And the mission of the program, as it says here, is to promote a sustainable relationship between people and their local landscapes. And it does this really by engaging community residents in exploring and celebrating the natural and cultural features that contribute to their town's character. And I want to just pause there. It's really this integration of nature and culture at the landscape level, which is really the hallmark of what we're trying to do with this program. And really, it's integrating certainly not just people from the university, it's a small part of it, but residents in the community, teachers in the community, and students in the community as well. So it's really meant to integrate across a diversity of backgrounds. So that's the mission of the program. And then we're really it's really also all about building relationships in place. And so we're really grateful, those of us at the PLACE program, which is really a partnership of University of Vermont and Shelburne Farms, and then whatever community we're working in this case, Burlington. And so we've got many partners. And some of our main ones are the Burlington City Department of Parks, Recreation, and Waterfront, the district, as I mentioned, Main Street Landing. I want to just mention briefly that coming up on Monday, kind of building on the series, is a presentation called Burlington Flowing, and it's going to take place on Monday, October 3rd at 7 p.m. right there in the theater of Main Street Landing above Skinny Pancake, not the train station. Some people get those confused sometimes, but it's the one above Skinny Pancake, and it's really going to look at all aspects of water. Everything from where our drinking water comes from to where our wastewater flows to, storm water, all connected to Burlington Bay, and trying to understand how that whole system works. So that's coming up Monday, just a few short days from now, October 3rd. And we're really grateful RETN is here tonight filming this. If you enjoy it tonight and want to share it with friends, they'll be able to go to the Burlington Geographic website and see these presentations again online. So thanks for that. And we have funding from the Henry David Thoreau Foundation. Many, many other partners who are associated with the upcoming four presentations. This is just the second in those. And here's the six-part series. I was getting ahead of myself here, but you can see we've started here. We're kind of building a layer of the landscape with the geology. Tonight's all about urban wilds in the Queen City, and really our urban forest and urban street trees are going to be featured into water. And then we're flowing in from there into the food systems of Burlington. These are all water systems, food systems, transportation systems, and finally culminating with energy systems. So it's a chance to really kind of for us to explore and hopefully demystify how these systems work, and particularly how they're integrated together. All right, well, tonight, without further ado, I'm going to just briefly say a few words about our presenters. Sean Beckett, who's going to be up here in just a moment, is a graduate student at the University of Vermont in a program called Ecological Planning. And it's in the Rubenstein School of Environment and Natural Resources. And Sean, I just can't say enough good things. You're really in for a treat tonight as he takes you on a tour of many of the urban wilds of Burlington, really from the bedrock geology up through wildlife habitat and with humans right in the center of all that. And so Sean has been researching Burlington all summer and photographing it, mapping it, reading the landscape, and here tonight he's going to be telling stories about it. And that'll be the first half of the program. Then we're going to have an intermission. There's going to be Shelburne Farms cheese out there and cider, all sorts of good things, and maps to ponder over. And then in the second half of the evening, we're going to build on that same theme, and Elise Schadler, I'm really pleased, from the Vermont Urban and Community Forestry Program of the state of Vermont is here tonight, and I've known Elise for a while, and she is just our expert, really, when it comes to urban forests. And many of our students at UVM, in fact, a number of UVM students are here tonight, who have just been working with Elise on inventorying the urban forests of Burlington and really trying to understand what are all the services provided by our magnificent street trees and park trees. So a lot more about that tonight. So that's the story, two presentations with a break in the middle, and thank you so much for coming out tonight, and let's welcome Sean Beckett up to the stage.
Well, thanks everybody for coming out here. Glad we sold out the whole place tonight, all 800, 900 seats. anyway, so thanks for the introduction. Well, it's really excited. This has been a big, tonight's a big culmination of a lot of work that many of us have been doing for the last several months. And I'm excited to tell you all about it. So in addition to being the kind of one of the coordinators for this Burlington Geographic series, I'm also, like Wall said, in the ecological planning program up at UVM. And my research there really focuses on one question, a big question, which is how do people connect with wild places? So a lot of us look at our forests as places that are, you know, like free of human intervention, outside of ourselves, something that's kind of separate from our society, some sort of an escape. And because of that, a lot of people never go into these wild places in our city. You know, a lot of folks think that, well, the woods are just nature. And, you know, since I'm not a nature person, then there's nothing in there for me. And so why bother going in there? But I'm really interested in getting people excited about our open spaces for other reasons. Because they contain a lot more than just, you know, nature and birds and butterflies and that sort of thing. If we really intend to protect our open spaces into the future, we need an entire community that's really deeply connected to these places for reasons that go beyond just their natural resources. So my goal tonight is to look at the forests in a different way. Let's look at them as a mirror that reflects our culture and our identity right back at us. Because hidden in our forests here in Burlington, or anywhere, are stories of our collective history. And this is especially true of our public parks, because as Burlington residents, these are literally our common grounds. And because they remain undeveloped and they're not paved over, they exist just layered with all the ways in which we've interacted with our open space through time. And so in some ways, stepping into our forest is kind of like stepping into this cultural time machine. So tonight I want to get us thinking about these open spaces in this particular way. And I want to do it by digging into a series of parks that are called Burlington's Urban Wilds. These are some of the lesser known areas in Burlington in a lot of ways. How many of you knew that there was actually a designation of parks in Burlington called the Urban Wilds? Wonderful. How many of you have been to more than one of them? Oh man, this is a select group here then. Great. How many have been to all six? Other than Dan and Alicia. anyway, these are city-managed parks. They're within Burlington's whole park network here. And they're really managed for their unique natural heritage. But they contain a lot more than that. And like I said, in most cases, they're hiding right in plain sight. So here's a quick overview of the six places I want to talk about tonight. We have Ethan Allen Park, which is one that probably most of you know about. We have Mackenzie Park down in the Innervale. We have right across the street from here is Arthur Park. Right behind this building is the Arms Grant Forest. Farther up North Ave is the Mount Calvary Red Maple Wetland. And way down in the south end is Crescent Woods. So to begin our journey, we're going to go right across the street from where we are today. Here's BHS. We're going to right across the street to this first urban wild called Arthur Park. This polygon is just the northern half of Arthur Park. So we're going to head down this old abandoned roadway. That's one of the main features of the park here. This road takes us from up here on the north end terrace where we are now down the hillside, down into the floodplain of the Innervale. So this path, it used to be the old way that you would get from the terrace up here down into the Innervale, and the Innervale Jersey Farm, which was owned and run by the Arms family, who we'll talk about a little bit later. They ran this place, and they would use this pathway to move their cattle back and forth every day from their upland pastures behind this building down into the Innervale. But my favorite story about Arthur Park and this roadway here comes from Charlie Auer, who's a longtime resident of Burlington. How many of you have been out to his place out by the bridge over the Nisky River, Charlie's Boathouse. Anyway, this is from Charlie here.
I had two tomato drums, and they're probably about 5 foot high. You crawl up and you get on there, you put your toboggan on it, and they had stairs or whatever. You get up there and get on the toboggan, and then they knock that hill, make sure there's nothing near there, and double run. And he would take and hit the hammer with a hammer, there's a big hook like you have in a door, and knock it down. When you did, the whole thing would tip up in the air, and down you would go, and you'd fly. I'm telling you.
So we get to the bottom of that toboggan ride, and in the winter this would be all iced over and you take your toboggan right across the lake. But let's say we throw on our ice skates, or in the summer we get in a canoe and we go right around the corner. So that path lets us out right about here. Let's say we go right around the corner to over here. And we find this nice, beautiful bedrock outcrop here, and we get up a little bit closer and we see this mysterious cave here. This is the Innervale Sea Caves, also known as Devil's Den. How many of you have never heard of Devil's Den or Innervale Sea Caves? All right, good. How many of you have been there? All right. So to describe this place for those of you that haven't been there, I'll turn it over to Levi Smith, who is a writer who lived on Willard Street back in 1907. He said, "In few places does nature reveal herself in so many and such diverse aspects as here at the Devil's Den, a great cave which stretches back into darkness, spanned by massive vaults and arches of weather-beaten rock, which ascend in unbroken curves and cast dark shadows and reflections in the water at their base. On the one side, there is always the view and the luxuriant marsh foliage, while on the other are high rocks festooned with thick hanging masses of nightshade as deadly as it is beautiful." But perhaps the greatest charm of this place lies in its seclusion. It is to all appearances as unfrequented and remote as if it were situated in the wilds of Africa. I don't know about with the belt line through there now, but still a pretty wild place. So when we're at the caves here, what stories are coming out at us? really we're looking into deep time. We're looking into the story that we were talking about last week, the story that shaped Burlington's whole physical stage. So to refresh a little bit on last week's presentation, these caves are really the product of two extinct saltwater bodies, the first being 500 million years old, give or take. And this is back when the whole of Burlington, the whole of Vermont was sitting underneath this iapetus ocean, this warm, shallow ocean. And it was over the years, it was collecting sand and silt and clay and volcanic ash and dissolved marine life that was just percolating to the seafloor over hundreds of millions of years. And the sediment, it congealed and it hardened over time into this beige limestone-like rock that we see throughout the northern part of Burlington called dolostone. And so this is the rock that's underlying this building right now. It's the rock that Ethan Allen Tower is made up of. The reason that BHS is split into seven different buildings is because of these pesky dolomite outcrops over here. So now we fast forward a little bit to 11,000 years ago to look at the other extinct saltwater body. So this is kind of the refresher on last week's presentation if you weren't there. This will catch you up to speed. So 11,000 years ago, 12,000 years ago, that ballpark, the glaciers are just starting to retreat from Vermont. And as it retreated north past the Champlain Valley, the St. Lawrence Seaway rushed in and it filled the whole Champlain Valley 200 feet higher with water than today's lake level, up to about 325 feet above sea level, and filled it in with this warm, a shallow water body called the Champlain Sea. And so during this time, imagine what the landscape may have looked like. This was right after the glaciers had retreated, and so Vermont's hillsides were left almost completely bare, and they were exposed to these massive erosion events. And so the Winooski River, imagine the Winooski River during this period. It was like this soupy mudslide or something like that, just completely inundated with all the sediment washing off from around the watershed across this exposed Vermont. So over time, the lake level of that Champlain Sea dropped slowly to where it is today. And on the way, wherever the lake level stabilized for a few centuries here or there, we get these giant sandy deltas that may have looked something like this, deposited wherever the rivers intersected the lake at the time. So imagine the Champlain Sea coming down, and imagine the lake level settling at about 165 feet above sea level, right about here. We're at the mouth of the Winooski River. We're looking southeast. That, in this rendering, at least, this is Camel's Hump. There's Mount Mansfield. Here's the whole New North End, Colchester over here. And imagine the Winooski River coming in and pouring into this water body farther up valley, depositing a big sandy delta across this whole region, which is responsible for the big flat terrain across, from here all the way across to Colchester. So then, over time, the lake level dropped some more and dropped down to where it is today. The Winooski River narrowed down. It had to cut its way through this big delta it created, almost like a knife through butter, and formed the Intervale Lowlands in the process. And then this river, as it meandered across this floodplain, it cut up against this delta and exposed the bedrock that was hiding underneath and exposed these caves that were pre-existing there. And over time, the river's force carving into these caves created these smooth and polished surfaces that we see when we go down there today. So let's put on these glasses again, this lens of landscape stories and cultural imprints in our area, in our explorations of our natural places. And we see that this old roadway here is a lot more than just a road now. It's a transect of Burlington's entire geological timeline, right? It's the path is cutting down through the Winooski River Delta from this ice age time. The path spits us out right at the story of Burlington's entire creation. And then, meanwhile, we're walking down this path and we're walking in the footsteps of generations of families and dairy farming families who this is, a major corridor, whether you're moving your cattle around or riding a toboggan. So the human stories, though, go back a lot farther than just toboggan and cattle roads in this area. These caves, the sea caves, were a really important Abenaki site as well. And in fact, the entire Intervale region, really, was the heart of the Winooskook Abenaki village for really thousands of years. So now I want to tie in our next urban wild that we're going to go over to. And this is Mackenzie Park. Here's the McNeil Power Plant. We're coming down the road through the Intervale, all the Intervale farm fields. Here's BHS, Arthur Park. Ethan Allen Homestead is right over here. To access Ethan Allen Park, you'd either come up the road through the Intervale Farms, or you park at the homestead and come around this way. So this is just a stone's throw away from Arthur Park. We're going to use Mackenzie Park here to explore some of the imprints of indigenous cultures in the region. So here's Charlie Delaney, and we're going to hear from Charlie Delaney speaking about the Abenaki use of this area.
That was the original Burlington, the Winooska village here. It was, for us, the river was the driveway to the lake, the major thoroughfare. So it was being on the inner rail of a place like Mackenzie Park, you didn't get the storm to rail the lake. It was a natural place. And every time, and over time, as the river meandered back and forth, we would just go with it. You know, sometimes the village might be right up against where the sea caves are. At other times, it may be meandered back right into Colchester. So over time, it went back and forth.
So that's kind of one layer to the story that's built into the physical landscape that we walk across when you go to Mackenzie Park. Let's add one more layer to this to make this you know, nature walk of ours a little bit more complex, a little deeper, a little bit more, a little richer.
When the Allens came here, Ira, Ebenezer, Ethan, they were not friendly to the original peoples here. So when they came in, they saw this as pockets of resistance. It's like, well, you know, we have this beautiful bottom and this inner veil, but we can't really live on it or sell it unless we get these people off it. They had to control it. They had to control the people that were there. They had to clear it. And that's what they did. Among our people, it was pretty well known that the Allens committed pogroms here. Something that, if you talk about that or even use that word here, people will look at you because they're thinking in terms of their history, and all of a sudden that spark of, well, I'm part of that.
So I wanted to highlight this story tonight, not to create controversy or get everybody riled up or anything, but just to really emphasize the depth of the types of stories that are inscribed right into our landscape. It's not unknown, it's not like a big secret that European settlers were responsible for removing the Abenaki community from this region, but it's not the type of thing that somebody thinks about when they're walking around on nature trails in Burlington. So to help close the loop of what I'm getting at here, I want to add one more layer here. So interestingly, for an indigenous community here that has had such a long history on the land in Burlington, there's surprisingly little evidence of it, not as much as you'd expect. Why is that? Why is the inner veil not completely chock full of you know, Abenaki evidence or artifacts, right? Well, to get to this, let's turn our attention back to our relationship with the Winooski River. So the whole reason we farm down in the Intervale is because the soils are really exceptional, right? They, you know, and that's because, you know, sediments are depositing across the whole Intervale just a fraction of an inch every year. You know, we have these big annual floods that come down. You can imagine sediment running off from farm fields and forest all the way, you know, up tributary, all the way to, at the headwaters, coming downstream, hitting the slow-moving waters throughout the Intervale, especially in the spring during, you know, high water, and depositing just a little bit of sediment across the landscape, just a fraction of an inch every year. But remember all that erosion I was talking about before, back when the glaciers were receding, all these bare hills that were exposed by the retreating glacier, right? Imagine what the landscape, compare that landscape to what things might have looked like in 1820 around here in Vermont. This was the beginning of the sheep craze, the Merino sheep craze in Vermont. This was the time when there was wholesale logging across all of Vermont's watersheds. It was the first time where there was major clear cutting across this whole state, really. First time that huge amounts of land were cleared, and ultimately all of the roots and the soils that were, well, all the soils that were being held in place by the roots and the trees were suddenly, you know, all those roots suddenly died or were cleared, and so the soil ran off into the rivers, creating this massive erosion event that was practically of a glacial scale. And so by some estimates, there's over 10 feet of sediment deposited over the whole intervale in just the span of a decade in some cases. So to get back to kind of closing this loop here, so the point is that not only had European settlers removed Abenaki from Burlington, but the colonial land use philosophy that followed across the whole state of Vermont was, you know, ultimately burying any Abenaki evidence deep under 10 feet of erosional sediment. So, you know, whenever there's an excavation project now in the Intervale and there's a reason to dig down deeper than just the plow line, it's amazing the things that are discovered. You know, projectile points, pottery shards, even in some cases human remains that are over 4,000 years old. So, again, this is the depth of what's imprinted into our physical landscapes. We walk around at Mackenzie Park and we put on our you know, cultural lens glasses here, and suddenly these paths, again, are a lot more than just nature trails. We see these forces of nature, we see these forces of water, forces of colonization, forces of indigenous agriculture, of colonial agriculture, of economics, of logging, of all of this stuff, all these dynamic forces that literally shape the landscape, right? From the orientation of the farm fields by the river to the ways in which the river literally bends, to the character and types of forests and trees that are growing here, to, you know, the pond outside of the sea caves and on and on. So now we're going to change gears a little bit. We're going to go to our third urban wild. This is a place that not many people know about, called the Mount Calvary Red Maple Wetland. Here's North Avenue. This is Plattsburgh Ave. If you come down here, Red Maple Lane, come behind the Franklin Square apartment area. The access point is right about here. You can also come in through the New Mount Calvary Cemetery, but this is the Red Maple Wetland. How many people have been there? Wow, that's amazing. You are maybe the only 10 people in the city that know about this place. So first, I just want to talk about vegetation here for a minute, and then I want to move on to something else. So we were just talking about how the New North End is this big sandy delta, right? And we walk into the site, or if we were walking in here and we hadn't been there before, we'd expect something. We'd expect, you know, this really well-drained soil, maybe white pines, sparse understory, just kind of like a dry, poor environment. We can kind of envision the type of forest that we'd see. But then we walk in here and we see this. It's a complete jungle. So for some reason, it's you know, really wet. It's inundated in some places. There's standing water for a good portion of the year, or at least in the spring, certainly. And it's mucky there today. And in terms of process, maybe, you know, the theory is that maybe when the Winooski River was cutting through this delta, there was some stagnant sidearm of the river that was cutting out through here, and the water was moving really slowly, and silts and clays were depositing, creating kind of a clay lens on top of the sand for water to collect in. But anyway, the point is that we have some of the driest adapted species and some of the wettest adapted species in our flora in the Champlain Valley growing right here side by side. So here we have a pitch pine. And this pitch pine, when you think of pitch pines, you think of like the Long Island Pine Barrens, New Jersey Pine Barrens, really, really dry places. These would have grown all across the New North End, across Colchester, all these flat sandy delta places, 500 years ago. Not so anymore. And then growing next to that is cinnamon fern, and nearby is royal fern. These are two of our most water-adapted ferns in our flora. You can see this stuff growing right out of the river if you go canoeing over in the Adirondacks. So anyway, really bizarre type of forest here. And you can think of it almost as a endangered forest. But to me, I'm really interested in figuring out how on earth this little piece of woods escaped development, how it escaped all the development across the whole New North End here in the sea of neighborhoods. In terms of cultural imprints, this park's existence at all is maybe its most interesting feature. So to understand this, let's peel back the layers of time and peel back the layers of maps and property lines to see what this parcel belonged to back at the beginning of kind of the colonial times. So this is the map of Burlington's, the first surveyed map of Burlington's New North End back in 1798. And if you look at the way the map is arranged, or look at the way these lots are arranged, you see that all these lots either abut the Winooski River over here or Lake Champlain, one or the other. And that's because, you know, back then there wasn't really a road system. Your roads, the water was your road, right? And so commerce happened by water. You moved by water. And so these lots, you know, all had to be long and narrow to maximize the number of people that could have access to water in one way or another. And they still had to have a lot of acreage because these lots were designed for farming. These lots were set aside with the intent of them being farmed. So to continue the story now, to contrast this, we fast forward to the turn of the 20th century. And at this point, Vermont is a major dairy producing region, right? And still is, but this is kind of when it all started. The farms were getting larger and larger. They were getting more and more competitive. And those farms that were the smaller farms, especially those that were operating on really poor soils, like those up on the New North End, they couldn't keep up. There was major competition, they just couldn't keep up. And so vast tracts of land were getting bought up and subdivided for a new purpose instead of farming, which is residential housing. So now, instead of needing each lot needing access to a lot of acreage and access to water, each lot now just needed access to a road and enough space to build a house on. So we see these long, thin lots pop up all the way through the New North End here. And there's not much acreage, there's not much thought to their backyards at all. Really, the goal was to sell houses along North Avenue and subdivide the pre-existing lot in whatever way best facilitated that. And so the Mount Calvary Red Maple Wetland ended up becoming part of seven different people's backyards. So usually subdivision is a bad thing for forests, right? That's something that we kind of have, you know, we kind of assume, you know, if something gets subdivided, that's it for the big patch of open space. But in this case, the reason and the way in which it got subdivided is maybe the reason it exists today. So each backyard was so thin that each property owner couldn't really do much with it. And the homes are so crowded in here along North Ave, there wasn't a whole lot of opportunity to build a side road in to access all of that. So these seven backyards here just kind of sat and treated as this unusable swampy area for the next like 50 years. So to add another really interesting layer to this story here, the time that this subdivision was happening was when Burlington was going through this big population boom due to waves of immigration of various ethnic communities. And we'll talk more about that at another Urban Wild too, but in a sense, the ethnic diversity of Burlington at this time, at the turn of the 20th century, is etched right into our physical landscape here. So let's meet the first seven families that moved into these seven new subdivided lots. Here in this one, we have Morris and Esther Brown. They were Russian and Polish immigrants. Here we have George Hollenbeek. He was a Dutch farmer. We have Frederick Shortsleeves, who had a Canadian father and a French mother. We have Israel and Mary Leroy, who are also French Canadian. We have Herman Stockinger, who was German. We have Joseph and Ernestine Gambero, who are Italians, and we have Moses and Blanche Plouffe, who were third-generation Vermonters by that point. So I think that's really fascinating. But it gets even better, because let's fast forward now to the 1960s. And we see another round of property division that intersects with Burlington's ethnic landscape here. So this is the 60s, this is this urban renewal period in Burlington when hundreds or maybe thousands of minority residents were being displaced from the downtown area. And during this period, the Burlington Housing Authority kind of emerged, and they put their sights on these seven parcels here, which included this Mount Calvary Red Maple Wetland area. And they acquired this for the goal of building a low-income apartment area to house those that were displaced from the urban renewal zone downtown. And so the Housing Authority, they acquired all seven of these lots, and they recombined them, and then they divided them into a front half and a back half. The front half they built Franklin Square on top of, and the back half was left as conserved lands. So getting back to this ethnicity piece here, in addition to the folks that I introduced before, you know, we can add in the 1990s, we look at the folks that were living in Franklin Square, and we have a lot of Bosnian and Serbian and Herzegovinian community members that had recently arrived. Today we have Somali and Nepalese and Bhutanese new Americans living in this area. So it's just this very international place, this very international story to this little chunk of woods here. And so, you know, we look at this parcel over time and we see that its whole existence is really thanks to changing property lines, but also this dissonance between how the lots were originally drawn and how that space was force-fit and tailored to the city planning and development and immigration kind of philosophies over time. And if you walk around in the woods, you can actually see evidence of this stuff. You can see these recombinations and divisions of property lines. You see it in these old fence lines that appear just out of nowhere and don't really make any sense. You see it in these long, thin strips of stump-sprouted trees that were once all logged at the same time. And logged at about the same time that the property changed hands during this kind of Burlington Housing Authority period. And you see it in high bush blueberries that are growing throughout this whole forest here, which I think are feral blueberry. I at least like to imagine, but I'd like to be proven otherwise, that these blueberry bushes are maybe relics of the 1800s prior to this subdivision when this area was a farm. So next spring, if you haven't been here, or even if you have, come back here, walk around in the trails, and you can pick delicious free blueberries right here in Burlington's woods. So I'm going to shift gears again, go over to our next urban wild. And this is one that a lot of people are familiar with. This is Ethan Allen Park. Here is Ethan Allen Parkway, North Avenue. This is the park that has the big, beautiful tower. On top, which is open every day throughout the summer. It's under construction right now, so if you're so jazzed about going up the tower after this talk that you just have to run over there, it's actually being repaired for the rest of the season, so you'll have to wait till next spring. Anywho, beautiful views off the top, and also throughout the whole park is just really wonderful, lush, rich foliage, really nice hike. So we were on this subject of all this immigration happening around the turn of the 20th century. So let's pick up on that theme and take a look at why this population boom was happening. And we'll see how this Ethan Allen Park emerged out of the sentiments of this whole period here. So the immigrants that were arriving in the latter half of the 1800s, just broadly speaking, they supplied the workforce of Burlington's industrial age. There was over 1,000 people working right down here at the Burlington lumber yards alone. There was a lot of people working at the Winooski textile mills. There was a lot of people working in this growing South End manufacturing district. Big changing time for Burlington. And out of this industrial period came the man maybe most responsible for Ethan Allen Park, which is this guy, William J. Van Patten. So Van Patten, he made most of his money producing medicines, producing dyes. He was higher up at the most profitable company in Burlington during this period, which is called the Wells Richardson Company. Anyway, he later became mayor, he became parks commissioner, and he decided to donate 15 acres of his land, and his land was the same lot that Ethan Allen himself had back in the day before him. He wanted to donate 15 acres of his land to the city of Burlington under the agreement that the Sons of the American Revolution would build this monument to Ethan Allen on top of the spot. And so this all happened in 1905. So when Van Patten did this, when he donated the parkland and when this tower got built, the city went crazy over this park. And it is actually hard to overemphasize how much people loved this park and how jazzed they were about this memorial ceremony. It's almost like it was the biggest event to ever hit Burlington by that period. There was 16,000 people that showed up for the dedication ceremony. There was red, white, and blue banners and bunting hung over every public building in town. There was a parade led by the cavalry that was marching through the whole town. There was a band playing in City Hall Park, which is on the other side of town from here. So it gives you an idea of how big of an event this was. The Vice President of the United States was speaking. I don't think that's him, but it looks like it could be. Anyway, part of the reason for this celebration here was that there's a couple reasons, but the one I want to focus on is that this is the first time that a space was set aside in Burlington for the purpose of public recreation. Again, this is 1905. This was a really much needed antidote to all of the congestion and chaos and smoke and smog of the Industrial Revolution. And here was a place within the city limits that you could go to escape all that was right at the end of the trolley line. So then 2 years after this donation of this land. We're in 1907 now. Van Patten put up another 50 acres of his land up for sale, the area that surrounded the tower and those outcrops. And then the city, or I should say the residents of the city, voted to buy up all that land. And this here is a pamphlet from the ballot measure back then. But anyway, for the first time in the city's history, we actually used money from the city budget to buy parkland. So this park became the crown jewel of Burlington's public spaces. There was lots of really great postcards and quotes that came out of this period. This one's from a woman named Madeline Brewster. She said, "It was a summer day, the year possibly 1918, when we boarded an open trolley. We traveled to the end of the line in Ethan Allen Park. And after eating a picnic lunch, rides on the swings and slides, we would walk upwards through a narrow path that led to Ethan Allen Tower, and then another long trek to the top. I can still remember the panoramic view of Lake Champlain and the Adirondack Mountains to the west, and Mount Mansfield and Camel's Hump to the east, etched against a blue sky." But thinking about cultural layers again, let's add in one more, because we should not forget that the site here, Ethan Allen Park outcrop, was a really important Abenaki site as well. The outcrop that this tower sits on was known for a long time as Indian Rock. So here's Abenaki leader Charlie Delaney again.
"That was a traditional meeting place for Abenakis, but it served one general purpose. It had a commanding view of the northern tier of the lake. And so you could see who's coming, who's going. So, for us, it was about, are the Mohawk coming our way? Are the Iroquois coming up the lake? Or in another time, who's coming? Is it these French or British troops? So it was a lookout, and these places always had year-round encampments."
So with all of this, let's think about this cultural imprint stuff again, and think about just the layers of human interaction with this one piece of land. So we walk through Ethan Allen Park, and we're walking up this prominent Native American meeting place. And to get there, we walk along these paths that Ethan Allen himself may have taken to get to his own homestead down in the Intervale. And we climb up this tower, and we notice that this tower was erected to commemorate Ethan Allen, Vermont's war hero, founding father, all this stuff. But the tower is built on top of a meeting space for the same people who he and his contemporaries helped remove from that landscape. And then we walk up to this beautiful view at the top, and along all these nice carriage roads, and we see these beautiful gazebos that were put in by Van Patten himself. And this guy just embodied Burlington's Gilded Age. And we're walking around on these paths in the footsteps of this Burlington community that absolutely adored this place because it was this local retreat from everything that was happening in Burlington at the time, this whole industrial period. So, changing gears again. We've talked about a bunch of spots up in the north end. Let's go to the south end. We're going to go to Crescent Woods here. This is Route 7. Down towards the South Burlington side. Here is the Subaru dealership. Here's Kinney Drugs. This is Prospect Parkway. Who's been into Crescent Woods? Oh, wonderful. All right, this is a biased crowd, but I love it. So when we left Ethan Allen Park, the tone of Burlington was starting to change. There's this increasing public support for parks. There's this general building sentiment around about open space and all this, and soon this post-industrial sentiment, it started to act on the way in which neighborhoods were being designed and not just parks. So that's kind of where Crescent Woods comes in. So this is now 1893, and there's this big publisher that just moved into Burlington from New York. His name was Henry Holt. And here we are at the top of the hill in Burlington. Here's UVM. We're just south here on top of Burlington Country Club. Holt built his estate here up on top of the hill where the country club now sits. And he bought up everything from his estate westward all the way down to Route 7. And after doing all this, he looked out over this beautiful view. He recognized how gorgeous this area was, and he loved the views. He loved the natural landscape of Vermont. But he wanted to do something to kind of protect this creeping outwards of the city of Burlington. And so he envisioned a new kind of neighborhood for this region. That would be Burlington's statement against this industrial period, maybe. And so to do that, Holt contracted Frederick Law Olmsted. And you know, those of you that know Olmsted, he was the country's most famous landscape architect ever. He was the guy that designed Central Park in New York City. He was responsible for Prospect Park down there as well. He was responsible for Shelburne Farms right down the road. And then when Olmsted retired, his sons took over the job, and the Olmsted brothers then drew up plans for this neighborhood between Prospect Street, which essentially runs right here, and then Shelburne Road is up there. Here's Proctor Ave. So this neighborhood, it would feature these kind of curved, winding roads, big open lots, design tailored expansive views out over the lake. It was really the first time that Burlington saw this fusion of park design principles and development planning kind of in one go. And Crescent Woods was a major piece of this design too. So here's that plan overlaid over Crescent Woods. In the 1930s, the Prospect Park Company, which is the company that was holding the interest to this neighborhood plan that Holt created, they put out an advertisement about this whole neighborhood, but focused on Crescent Woods in particular. He said, "Those nature lovers who for many years, both winter and summer, have enjoyed the glenway that runs from Lower Prospect Street to Shelburne Road will readily visualize its future development, banked with wildflowers and rock gardens, ferneries and shading groves, with a path following the brook course for the enjoyment of all residents of the park." So unfortunately, though, Holt died before the plans for this Prospect Park neighborhood could be finished. And then after that, this was the mid-1920s, then the Great Depression hit, and then World War II followed that. And so for this whole period, generally speaking, the whole housing market in town and I guess elsewhere was way down. And so this landscape, even though it had been prepared for this development, to the extent that a lot of the roads were even put in and some other things that we'll see, this area just kind of sat empty. And then on the flip side, after the war, the housing market boomed and developers came in and bought up all these lots and they subdivided it even more, and they put in three times as many houses across these roads as Olmsted brothers and Holt ever intended. And all this is laid out over this road network that was designed, you know, 50 years beforehand for an entirely different intent. And meanwhile, the Crescent Woods is just sitting over here completely ignored during this time. But today, you walk into Crescent Woods and you find this feature that brings you right back to this park's original design intent. It's this beautiful stone bridge that was built as part of the Olmsted brothers' design for this Prospect Park neighborhood in 1914. And here's, this is Clymer Street, Shelburne Road. This is the bridge on those plans back in 1914. And so it's thanks to the protection of this little part of Englesby Brook here, thanks to its protection as an urban wild, that we've, you know, almost consequently or coincidentally conserved this bridge too. And in doing so, we've also conserved all of these great stories and heritage around our evolving philosophies, you know, around development and land use planning and so forth. So all of that brings us to the urban wild that we're at right now, or right in front of now. Here's BHS, we are right there. And this is the Arms Grant Forest. And I want to introduce you to the Arms family, because they lived on this exact spot where we sit for the 40 years before BHS was built back in 1962.
Our farm was about 360 acres, most of it on the Innervale, but quite a bit of it also was up where the Burlington High School is now, and also down to the Elks Club. Mm-hmm. We used to have that pasture there along North Avenue. We used to cross our cows every morning and every night across North Avenue. And, you know, when they first set up the farming there, that was like the end of the line. The trolley cars went out, and they turned at North Beach and went back. That was the turning point. He and my mother ran that farm. They ran lots of other businesses, though. they were also in the milk business. I mean, they not only had the cows, but they also had a processing plant. A little, he was a producer dealer, and he bottled milk. He had the Jersey Creamline franchise.
So the Arms dairy business was running during this time when everything around them, all these other upland farms up in the New North End, were being split up and sold off and developed in this big population boom that followed World War II in the mid-1900s. This same population boom that affected that Prospect Park neighborhood where Crescent Woods now sits. And so in a way, it's almost because of the success of the Arms dairy business that this place exists today. And you know, it's because of that, you know, that that we have this. So eventually, though, the Arms property did change hands. But by that time, the housing boom had quieted down, and Burlington's relationship with open space had evolved some more. Florence and Willard Arms, who you saw in the photos there, they were both really major proponents of conservation and also environmental education. And to take a really long story and condense it really simply, this whole 54-acre part of their property, which includes BHS and the whole forest around it, this is the rock. This is Rock Point over here, by the way. So yeah, 54 acres, this whole thing, it was sold in 1962 to build BHS. And this land transfer happened under the agreement that the leftover land that wasn't built on top of here, everything behind the high school, would be set aside for recreation, but specifically for education. So we've talked about a bunch of ways in which Burlington's wild lands came to exist tonight. And this one, for the first time in Burlington's history, it was a forest that was set aside for the sake of education, and we have milk to thank for it, ultimately. So now let's apply this lens we've been working with this evening, and seeing our natural landscapes for their cultural imprints. And we see that the Arms Forest is a great example. It's just brimming with stories of these kinds of things. For those of us that were on the field walk on Saturday in and around the Arms Grant property, we uncovered some of these mysteries. But I'll show some scenes from around the forest, and we'll talk about really quickly what sort of stories are pouring out of these images. So take this one here, right? This is not just a trail going over a hill. This is stories of rocks and soils forming underfoot. This is a story of Burlington's entire, geologic, stage and creation and all of that. This is, a 500-million-year-old ocean. This is ice ages. This is everything. Maybe that's a little bit overwrought, but nevertheless. Then we go and we go up closer on these outcrops. We see these beautiful, uncommon, rare plants that are throughout this property that grow here only because of this combination of soils and bedrock and water that all come together just right at this one spot. We walk out more and we see the sharp divide between a field and a forest. And we ask ourselves, what's going on there? And we realize that these rectilinear lines are relics of the property lines that Ira Allen himself drew back, in the 1700s. And we realize that oftentimes when you do see these sharp transitions in habitat type, they can be mapped onto these old maps of Burlington's first divisions. We duck into the forest, we find this big old oak tree. We take a core sample or ask it politely, and it says that it's 200 years old. And we realize that this tree here, we count back 200 years from today, we realize that this tree was one of the first trees to regrow following the massive clearing of Vermont in the 1820s. So this is kind of a relic of that time. We walk some more and we find this old abandoned quarry back here. And we realize that this rock is made up of that dolostone, but that dolostone was known as marble to the marble industry, at least. The only marble quarry excavated in the city of Burlington, and it was excavated at the turn of the 20th century by all these marble finishing companies down on Pine Street. And so even here, we have this fingerprint of the Industrial Revolution sitting right here in the middle of the Arms Forest. It was actually a BHS student that showed me this quarry for the first time. We walk around some more, we find that all the widest trails in this property, they ultimately come back to the high school. And we think about why that might be, and it's because, well, the high school, before it was the high school, was the site of the Arms Dairy Farm. And so these roads would be how the Arms would move their cattle back and forth throughout that pasture each day. So pulling all this together here, we've been looking at all of our city parks, all of our urban wilds here in isolation. But let's look at them as a collection of parks, because it's really the collection of our parks that means a lot more than just the sum of the parts, right? You know, we're reminded that all these different stories that, you know, I'm talking about, and a lot more that are locked into these places, they collectively represent Burlington's whole relationship with open space through the ages. You know, we have deep geologic forces that shape the land beneath us at Arthur Park. At Mackenzie, we're looking at millennia of indigenous land use and early sediment agriculture. At Mount Calvary, we're looking at land division, housing markets, ethnic diversity. Ethan Allen Park, we're seeing Gilded Age park planning, we're seeing parks as part of neighborhood designs, and we're even seeing commercial dairy lands that are set aside for the sake of education. So my goal tonight was to inspire hopefully a different way of looking at the blank spots on our maps, right, our wildlands. Instead of thinking about them as some kind of escape from our society, thinking about them as features that reflect ourselves and our culture right back at us in the same way that our built environments do. These places here, they give us glimpses of who we are as individuals and as a whole city of Burlington, and we can really use them to see where we've come from through time. And as we move forward, as neighbors of Burlington, let's think about how people 200 years from now are going to look into their urban wilds, their open spaces, and maybe we can wonder what sorts of stories they'll be able to uncover here. So lastly, I hope that I've piqued enough curiosity in everyone here to go explore some of these places. And I encourage everyone to put on that hat of the treasure hunter, of the explorer, and go into some of these places and see what sort of stories you can find. And the last thing I really want to quickly say is there's going to be a lot more information about all these urban wilds appearing on Burlington Geographic's website, as well as the Burlington Parks and Rec website. So if you're wondering how the heck to get to these places and you want to know a little bit deeper about some of these stories, that'll be available on our website in the coming weeks, hopefully. And many thank yous to all the folks that made this presentation possible. So thank you. I want to do a couple of quick announcements before we turn things over to a brief intermission so y'all can get your fill of Shelburne Farms cheese and apple cider and that sort of thing. And I'll have Alicia and Henry come up here while I'm saying a couple other things. I mean, Harry, sorry. First of all, we have some great field walks coming up over the next couple weeks. There's information on those out outside next to the big maps. We have a great one coming up on October 8th, which will be a bike trip across the waterfront area of Burlington that will be interpreted by some of the field naturalist graduate and undergraduate students up at UVM. It'll be a great time if you're interested in joining us for that bike trip or any of the other field walks, sign up out there. I also want to mention that on October 10th, Gail Rosenberg and Elise Gayette are going to be doing a wonderful presentation on kind of the food landscape in Burlington through time. And if you want to prep yourself for their talk and you want to join one of them for one of their Burlington Edible History Tours, there's another maybe 1 or 2 weeks left in their season. So two weeks left in the season. So sign up for those now. They're a lot of fun. And I learned a lot. And I'll turn it over to Harry real quick.
Hi, my name is Harry. I'm in a UVM class that's helping Burlington Geographic solicit you guys in response to the lectures and the survey. So our research is just about how they can best help you guys educate and connect with the Burlington area. I have a couple colleagues of mine in the back that will be out there with the snack area, hopefully distributing some surveys to you guys. It will only take maybe 5 minutes, and it's anonymous. We won't share your name or private information with anyone, but if you would like to leave an email address for a follow-up survey around November, please just write it down on the survey. Thank you.
And I'll turn it over to Alicia as well. Thank you, Harry.
My name is Alicia Daniel, and I'm a field naturalist with Burlington Parks, Recreation, and Waterfront. And as much as I love working with Sean and I love the cultural imprint on the landscape, for some of us, nature is reason enough to go out into these parks. And if you are one of those people, I want to announce that we're doing a new program for you. It's called the Master Naturalist Program, and we're going to be reading landscapes in this layer cake way through the season. So we'll start with geology in August, and then move into the glacial history in October, and looking at natural communities, and then wildlife in winter, and come back around to the cultural and conservation history later in the spring. So we have a pilot group of 10 people that are running through the program now, and we're looking for the second class. So if you have any interest in signing up for that, the thing that we're requiring, at least for this initial set of people, is that you be a Burlington resident, and hopefully that you have a sustained interest in some layer of the landscape, maybe it's birds, maybe it's plants, and that you be willing to give back 12 hours of your time, either to conservation education, maybe working in schools, or to stewardship, working in the natural areas, in return for this retraining. So if you're interested in it, I'll be standing in the back taking names and email addresses, and I really appreciate it. So I've been doing conservation education for, I just learned from my LinkedIn profile, 27 years and 3 months. So I love that, but what I love even more is spending time in these wild places in Burlington, and I hope that we'll be able to keep them wild for generations to come.
All right, welcome back, everybody. How is the cheese? Glad to hear it. There'll be more of that next week. Tonight we've been learning a little bit about the story of our evolving relationship with our forests here in Burlington, right? But where we left off was really in the early 1960s, in this time when BHS was being built and that whole story. But since then, our relationship with our forest resources has continued to evolve quite a bit, and particularly because of our growing attention towards our street trees here in Burlington. So I want to introduce our next speaker, Elise Schadler, who will kind of pick up on this thread and share some awesome stories about this side of our urban forests. So Elise is currently the Technical Assistance Coordinator for the Vermont Urban and Community Forestry Program. This is a really cool organization that works with towns and cities across Vermont to manage and take care of their town forests, their street trees, these kind of common resources that they are. Elise is a certified arborist. She did her graduate work up at UVM in natural resource management up at the Rubenstein School. Elise is also an awesome storyteller. She and her husband host this great community food and storytelling event series called Bird to Branch that I met. Who has been to a Bird to Branch series? All right, a bunch of hands. Great. Anyway, if you haven't been, I promise you will really enjoy them if this is your cup of tea tonight. So ask her all about Bird to Branch after the show tonight. But please help me welcome Elise Schadler.
Hello. Okay. So my name is Elise Schadler, and like Sean said, I work for the Vermont Urban and Community Forestry Program. So we are kind of a collaborative effort between University of Vermont Extension and the Vermont Department of Forests, Parks, and Recreation. And we work statewide, and I coordinate our technical assistance to communities. So that ranges from going out and advising on specific tree issues to helping write ordinances and management plans, etc. So this is a very different type of talk for me, because I usually am asked to talk about specific, you know, biology or pruning or specifics of doing an inventory or whatnot. So this is a fun topic, placemaking and trees and identity in Burlington. So I want to thank Sean for asking me to do this, and Walter for leading the charge of this great program. I'm also a Burlington resident, though. So this is a fun topic, not only because urban forestry is my field, but because I love our city, and I particularly love my neighborhood, the Old North End. I moved here in 2009 for graduate school and pretty quickly decided that this is where I wanted to make my home, to put my roots. lots of root puns coming your way from my roots down. So Luna and I take two walks every day, and so I love trees, but I've also been able over the last 7 years to really spend a lot of time with our urban trees, our street trees and our park trees, get familiar with them, benefit from them. And then I also, as Sean mentioned, love community storytelling. So I have coordinated these community storytelling events with my husband, Sam, who's somewhere in the audience. It's a storytelling plus dinner kind of thing, and we've done them in interesting, cool places all over the city and in the area, such as the Moran plant a couple years ago. So I thought it appropriate to maybe just start with a couple of stories tonight. So, story number one. Who knows what this is? What's it, Nancy? What is it? It's a live oak. This is the angel oak. It lives near Charleston, South Carolina. And it's a southern live oak, Quercus virginiana. It is one of my favorite trees, even though I don't come from the south. It's an evergreen oak species, and very based in southern culture. It's kind of a symbol for strength and resilience, and all that southern culture is. And they don't grow very tall, maybe 60, 70 feet, but their limb span can reach well over 100 feet across. And the circumference of these trees can, you know, 8, 9 feet around, and they're long-lived species. In the late summer of 2006, Hurricane Katrina hit the Gulf Coast of our country, as everybody here knows. And a couple weeks after the storm, I was shipped down to Gulfport, Mississippi, with 200 other young, encouraging people as part of the AmeriCorps National Civilian Community Corps, which I was doing for a year. And I'd never seen anything like this. We were there 3 weeks after the storm. And the first day we were in Gulfport, we went for a drive down State Route 90, which runs right along the coast. And I remember looking kind of to my right and just seeing, you know, neighborhoods and strip malls and casinos and parks and elementary schools that were just flattened and feeling, you know, this sense of like, oh my goodness, like what, this is just so much to take in. And then I remember looking to my left out into the Gulf and seeing these live oak trees that were on their side that had been uprooted and had, you know, the shallow waters, the waves kind of lapping up against them, and that's what really got me. And just thinking about these, you know, 500-year-old trees that were just pulled out of the water. And, you know, so many of the people that we worked with that year, when we were down there, they felt the same way. So even though they had lost all their possessions and their homes, it was almost like, for some of them, the loss of these trees was much more traumatic. So much so that 6 months later, when we went back, we were invited to take part in a display of aerial art on the beach in Gulfport. And this was a community celebration of resilience and hope. And that's a live oak tree. And that's me, right there. Story two. In 2006, I took a job as the director of a community-based urban tree planting program in Camden, New Jersey. If you've never been to Camden, it is a city that has been riddled with a variety of environmental and economic and social issues since it started losing its population base back in the mid-century. I had never been to New Jersey. I didn't know anything about Camden. I was in way over my head, and this was me on my first day. And the program was all volunteer tree planting. It was free trees for residents. And they threw me right in and said, we've got 50 trees to plant, you're in charge of everything. So I'd never planted trees this big before. I had never organized as many logistics as you need to make a successful tree planting happen when it's all done by volunteers and the trees are 800 pounds apiece. But somehow we managed to do it. And we put in about 50 trees around a Franciscan church in a Hispanic neighborhood in Camden. And I was very frazzled, as you can imagine. It was just like, but really high on the energy of like, wow, we did it. We got all these trees in the ground. And I noticed shortly after the event kind of was fizzling down that there were these neighborhood girls that were like huddling around a tree, and then they'd like giggle, and then they'd like run over and like huddle around a new tree and giggle. And I was like, well, what's going on over there? And I kind of walked over and asked them, and they were they had these popsicle sticks with names on them, and they were putting one on each tree. So they named all 50 trees. And I was just astonished. I was like, wow, that was quick, and this is amazing. Like, you live in this barren concrete world, and already you're feeling a connection to this thing that's been put in the ground. And shortly after that, when I was kind of walking around with these girls, we heard some commotion down the road, and I looked up and I saw this, which is Friar Judd and Friar John blessing every single tree with holy water. So over the next 3 years, I worked with the Tree Foundation until I came up to Vermont, and I ended up leading about 70 tree planting events and getting over 2,000 trees in the ground, with volunteers, and this was my introduction to three really pivotal years of being right in that kind of that soup of why people are connected to nature and why it's important for us to bring trees into cities. As an urban forester, a really big part of my job is trying to communicate the value of trees. So we know there's all these benefits of trees in cities and why they're important. There's all of these ecosystem services that trees produce and they provide for us. And we are in an age now where we can actually quantify a lot of those services. So, you know, air quality improvement, stormwater mitigation. We can do carbon sequestration and storage. We can do water quality improvement, heat mitigation. We can quantify that, and it's a really powerful tool to be able to put a dollar sign onto those values, and then talk to decision makers about why this is an investment worth putting money into. But you know, the thing that really has kept me interested in urban forestry and kept me really passionate about what I do is a little bit harder to put your finger on, I think, and it is that connection piece. It's, you know, why do we feel, you know, I'm sure you all have felt that you have a favorite tree and you feel that connection to this organism. There's a lot of research around the social and community building well-being types of benefits of trees as well. We know that citizens that have access to common green spaces in urban areas, you know, have a better sense of community. They feel more united with their neighbors. They feel a sense of belonging in their neighborhoods. We know that access and ample green space in neighborhoods reduces stress, and it equals better public health. It equals more people outside recreating, using spaces, more people knowing their neighbors. We know that nature education is really important for children. It helps with creativity and cognitive development and intellect development and building social relationships. So there is research that is starting to kind of fill in those gaps a little bit more, but it's still harder, you can't put a dollar sign on that as well as you can ecosystem services. But we feel connected to them, and I think a big reason for that is that trees are touchstones. You know, they're not going anywhere. They're in a place, and they're part of that place. And we watch them change throughout the seasons, and we watch them grow over the years, and we celebrate when we get to plant them. And we mourn when they reach the end of their natural lives. So, they really, I think, help define the character of a place. And this is where this conversation is. We live in this place with this beautiful urban forest, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about it. And I hope that when you leave here tonight, in addition to all that great stuff you learned from Sean about the urban wilds, there's kind of three things. Like, one, I hope you learn a little bit about the history of our urban forest, which segue or side note, urban forest, I'm talking mostly about street and park trees. So these are the trees in the public right-of-way, public trees that are managed by the city have been planted by the city. So I hope you learn something about the history. I hope you gain some kind of appreciation for not only those trees that work so hard to keep us happy and healthy and keep our environment what it is in Burlington, but also the people that are their stewards. And I hope that you maybe think about your own connection to trees and reflect on why they have meaning in our lives. So to dig in, when I travel, I look at a new place through the lens of its trees. You know, I know some people go to a new city and they want to explore all the architecture, and some people want to see all the food, and some people go for the breweries and the beer. But for me, it really is the public trees. And so many a day I've tripped or ran into something because I'm often walking around new cities like this, because that's where all the action is. So what do our trees say about Burlington? What would a visitor that maybe looks at cities through the same lens see about Burlington through our trees? I think the great place to start is with some history. So we're going to do a little history of Burlington's urban forest. And I'm just going to say a quick note on photography. So most of these photos are mine, my own. I've borrowed a couple from Warren Spinner, who's our city arborist. And then the historical photos I've also borrowed from Warren, but he got them by way of UVM Special Collections. They are part of the McAllister photos. So Lewis McAllister was a Burlingtonian who took a lot of pictures of Burlington kind of in the early 1900s through mid-century. So these are mostly McAllister photos. I don't have dates for a lot of them, and I usually kind of try to guess based on the car styles, but in the buildings, but generally in the 30s, 40s, and 50s is when most of these pictures are taken. So this is, you know, Burlington. Here's campus. You know, Burlington, like a lot of New England and Midwestern cities, there was developed with American elm as the dominant street tree. American elm is a species that grows really fast. It seeds prolifically. The shape of the tree, or the form, is kind of a coveted vase-like shape, so it grows very straight up with a single stem, and then it umbrellas out at the top. So you get this form that really shades over roads and streets really well, and also, you know, if it gets over the buildings, it just provides a really awesome canopy. If you can imagine, Burlington at one point had over 10,000 American elms in our public tree population. So you can imagine looking down at some point, it probably would seem like less of a city than it actually was. So UVM, part of Burlington, obviously, was also heavily, heavily treed in elm. And the green, while at one point was, I believe, a sheep pasture, was, at you know, in the early century, kind of converted into like an elm forest on the green. So we have these photos. This is University Place, right? That's the in front of kind of the main strip up on campus on the green. These are all elm trees. This is a little hard to see, but it's College Street looking north up to campus. So I think Waterman would be over here. These are all elms. And you can see that shape. It really kind of closes the canopy. This is Battery Park from the 1938, I think is the year on this. All elms. This is when they were building the wall. There's the wall. 38. All elms. This is Winooski Avenue. I don't know exactly where, but I love the old streetcar. All elms. I believe this is Elmwood Ave. Also, elms, elms, elms. You're getting the pattern here. I think this is Pearl Street. This might be looking towards the lake. That looks like really early. This is Roosevelt Park, which is my neighborhood park that I love. These are probably elm right here underneath, but this is also Roosevelt Park. This is Union. Looking, you know, north on Union Street from South Union Street, all elms. And this is Winooski, kind of where the Route 7, that junction down in the south end. And then this is St. Paul Street. So the theme, common theme in all of these historical photos is we had a lot of elm trees planted. And you know, now we know that monoculture is not always a good thing. So Dutch elm disease hit the U.S. in the 1930s, and it's a symbiotic relationship between an Asian fungus and a European beetle, a bark beetle, that carries the fungus from tree to tree. So the fungus came from the West Indies, and then the beetle came by way of Europe, and they both came by way of wood products, and really devastated a lot of our cities because we lost so many elms. Burlington was not spared, and like I said, Warren estimates that we lost about 10,000 between the early 1950s and now. We had one in our backyard that we just had to cut last year, so it finally succumbed to Dutch elm disease. It moves pretty quickly through the tree, and you know, there's not really anything you can do for the tree unless you're treating it ahead of time. But they didn't know that then. So, you know, we lost a lot of trees, and what was whatever money there was in city budgets across the country for tree planting really had to be shifted to mitigating the risk of having tens of thousands of dead trees on the roads. And at first, this is OSHA would not. It's like crazy. But at first, we were really trying to treat, and this is DDT. DDT was what was recommended for treatment, and it was heavy in the crown and 100% trunk coverage. So it was really dousing these trees in DDT. But it was not effective, and eventually most of the trees had to come down. Sean found a bunch of old Burlington Free Press articles for me that were really fun to read through. These are all from like the late 50s and early 60s. Oh, they're really fun. But so, you know, they start out, this is kind of the very beginning, 1957, I think this one was, where they first start seeing Dutch elm, and they're talking about how they're going to spray with DDT and how they do that. And then we've got 58 city trees doomed, more yet to go, time and a half sought for late work on trees because all the city workers were just having to spend much more time on removals. Dead trees are a lot more hazardous to remove than live trees, as you can imagine. New rules will give city and new trees better breaks, so they are still trying to plant some trees, and it's actually in here, it's very hard to read, obviously, but something about city residents could apply and ask for a tree in front of their house for $6. You know the cost of trees now, it's just pretty crazy. And then, you know, this is a long-range planting plan may replace dying elms. So this is where, like, looking at this group of articles as a very small snapshot in time, it's clear to me that even then the city was thinking about long-term planning and that they were going to have to focus more on planting instead of just spending all the money and on removals in order to keep any kind of semblance of an urban forest. This is a photo of a photo of Rose Leland, who's the grounds manager up at UVM, sent me this the other day, and it's a photo that she keeps on her corkboard or whatever that is, and it's the removal of the last large elm from the UVM green. UVM has no historic elms left on campus. This was the last one that was being, this is obviously from the bucket, top of the bucket truck, and this was the remnants of that last tree, and it was in the 1990s. So as you can imagine, by the 80s, 70s, 80s, this is what a lot of streets in Burlington looked like. It was really denuded, and really, I think having this perspective of thinking, you know, 30 years ago, we didn't have the trees that we have today. In comes Captain Warren Spinner. Who's met Warren in here? Okay, Warren is our city arborist. He started as the city arborist in 1980, and he was the very first official city arborist before the parks deputy or director was in charge of making decisions about trees. But Warren was hired in 1980, and I'm not going to say if this is true or not, but the anecdote goes that Mayor Bernie Sanders pounded his fist on the table and said, Warren, you are going to reforest this city. And so he did. The city started a really aggressive tree planting campaign in the early 80s. In 1983, they kicked it off with 600 trees planted by volunteers in one day. And this was a really big deal. So they really wanted to bring trees back to Burlington. So this is that day. This is Charlotte Street in the South End in 1983. And this is Charlotte Street in 2014. This is Monroe Street. This is my first apartment in Burlington. This is 1983 Monroe Street. This is Monroe Street in 2014. So it's trees make a huge difference, and it's really obvious when you see that comparison. This is not 1983. This is much older than that, but this is where the Davis Center is. So this is Main Street, and this is the reservoir or whatever, that thing up there that people don't know what it is. Up the top of the hill on campus. So this is just to highlight elms. In 1998, or close to 2000, they started releasing kind of backbred, disease-resistant varieties of American elms. So Burlington, like many other cities, really was eager to plant these trees because to maintain the legacy of American elm in our country. So we've planted, I think, about 250 over the course of the last 15, 20 years. So these are disease-resistant varieties. And so when you're driving on Main Street up past campus, all the trees that are lining along the side with the Davis Center are elms. And here they are. So this is 2014. And they're doing really well. So one thing that we learned that a lot of cities didn't learn was, again, that lesson about monocultures. So Burlington has about 12,300 trees in its inventory right now for street and park trees, so more than we had lost. I know a lot of cities in the Midwest basically replanted with five species, and two of those species are currently under threat from other invasive insects right now, so they're dealing with this all over again. I can say with pretty good confidence, after doing a lot of inventories in Vermont, we're not seeing the same case in Vermont communities except for Stowe. This is Burlington's kind of the diversity breakdown right now. So we've got a lot of crab apples because they do well under power lines because they don't grow too tall. But we've got a lot of species. There's about 50 that are planted throughout the city, including some cultivars, so give or take 50 species. And we don't have anything that's much above 10% of the total population. And most things are much less than 5% of the total population. So we have a really diverse urban forest. And this is a spread of our diameter classes. So this, you know, we can translate this to general age of our urban forest. So we see that we don't have a lot of stuff that is over 30 inches in diameter. So we lost that kind of all those older large trees when we lost the elms, and we're rebuilding right now. So you can see this big spike in the 7 to 12 inch range. That's really when Warren came in and started this planting program, and we've sustained it. So we're not planting 600 trees a year now, but we are still, the city does still plant about 130 to 150 a year. The second major event in the history of Burlington's urban forest was the 1998 ice storm. So who was here for this? A big deal. It hit the higher elevations in Burlington, the trees in the higher elevations, harder than kind of on the waterfront, but lost about 10% of the tree population. And after the 98 storm, the community really rallied around trees in Burlington and really wanted to bounce back quicker than we had with Dutch elm. So a couple years later, a dedicated tax passed in the city that really laid the foundation for Burlington having a well-funded tree program. So I work with urban foresters all over the country, and I can tell you with per capita, Burlington has one of the best urban forestry programs in terms of the amount of resources that our city arborist has at his disposal to take care of our trees. In addition to Warren, we've got four full-time think four, I'm looking at Dan, four full-time arborists, field arborists that are out there every day. I'm sure if you live in town, you know your street gets closed down every once in a while so they can prune the trees. There's also seasonal staff that come on in the summertime. They've got two bucket trucks. They're all certified arborists. They're also, I think most of them are utility certified arborists, which means that Burlington Electric actually pays the city of Burlington to prune under utility lines, which other cities just don't have that capacity. So we really have a great program. Every tree in Burlington is touched at least every 4 years through a pruning cycle. And thinking 12,300 trees, it's a lot of trees. So we've got a great program now, and I know it's one of the main reasons I feel like I fell in love with Burlington so much. The other thing of note is the Branch Out Burlington group. So I know Nancy's here from Branch Out Burlington. Branch Out Burlington is the volunteer group, tree stewardship group in Burlington. And in 2000, the community tree nursery was established. So this is a really unique thing in Burlington that's really awesome, that basically trees are brought in as bare root small trees and planted by volunteers in this nursery every May, the first weekend in May. And then those trees are planted out along the streets in throughout the city. So when there's a new street tree that goes in that green belt between the sidewalk and the street, this is where it came from. And it was planted by volunteers, it was taken care of by volunteers, and it was planted by our city staff. So it's very connected, very Vermont-y. There you go. So those are our trees. So there's 21 different genus and 30 different species at the nursery right now, and over 1,200 trees have been planted out of that nursery. The planting is on the first Saturday of May, and we're always looking for volunteers, and it's really fun, and it's at the UVM Hort Farm is where the nursery is located. Here's just another picture of planting day. Branch Out Burlington is also always looking for volunteers, so if anybody's interested, they meet once a month, I think the second Tuesday of the month. There's always baked goods. They're very friendly. They do a number of events, such as a tree walk. They have a winter seminar. They have a tree class every April. And right now, they're taking nominations for the Awesome Tree Contest. So if you have a favorite tree in town, you can nominate it, and then it might win. And then you get pizza and prizes. So this is a really great group of people, and I've been happy to be able to work with them in a number of capacities. So we're going to come back to this question as we kind of wrap up. What do the trees of Burlington say about this place and about our identity and character as a city? I don't know, Luna, what do you think? So I had a really fun time with this presentation, not only putting it together, but just walking around and riding my bike around the past couple of days and kind of trying to take pictures of kind of my favorite things about our urban forest. So that's what's left. So here's some things that I love. I love that it's a diverse urban forest, and that I think because we're also on a hill, it just makes for really interesting textures. It softens the landscape. They're really interesting textures to look at. Every once in a while you find something that you didn't know was there, like the shagbark hickory. I like that we have trees that are intermixed with our built environment, that kind of these places that have really defined edges, they get blurred a little bit by foliage and branches in the wintertime. I think that our city planners, with Warren Spinner and with the residents that have been involved, have been really intentional and thoughtful about planting trees in public places in a way that makes it feel special and different and also familiar. So this is down the waterfront. So everybody loves the Honey Locust LA down Battery Street. It's our City Hall Park. I love that I know that these trees were planted by people in Burlington that care about trees, and they were weeded by people in Burlington that care about trees, and they were watered by people in Burlington that care about trees, and they were planted by people that are trained to know the right way to plant the right tree in the right place, and that they are subsequently cared for by those same people, so that not only are they taken care of as young trees, but they're pruned in a way that they have structural integrity throughout their life. And these are going to be long-lived shade trees that provide benefits for many, many years, which is what we really want for an urban forest. But most of all, I love the stories, and I love the intimacy of seeing something like every day and being able to watch something every day and being familiar with something. So, you know, I feel like it's you're like in on this little secret, and this was such a fun thing to ride around yesterday and take these photos of all my little like favorite secret tree stories, which I'm going to tell you all right now. So this is a Camperdown elm. It's up on Champlain College's campus on Willard and Maple, and it's old, it's gnarly, it's got these weird cankers and wounds all over it, but it's such an awesome tree, and if you haven't ever seen it, go say hi to it. There's the Giving Tree that is new. This is on Maple Street, and you take a book, you leave a book, help yourself. It's a giving tree. There's this American Elm Tree that is very special because it will hopefully grow into a really, really large urban downtown tree because it was planted in a system called a silva cell, which is essentially, think about milk crates put under the soil, underground, filled with a lot of good organic soil that is gonna give this tree soil volume and enough rooting space to grow into a large tree while also mitigating a ton of stormwater. So this was a system that was installed, I think, in 2010 or 11, and now Burlington has a number of these, but this was the very first one. So this is right across the street from Ben & Jerry's. It's a special tree. There's the biggest tree in Burlington, an eastern cottonwood in the south end. There's my favorite tree in Burlington, which is this hackberry, northern hackberry on Intervale Avenue, which also might be the biggest in the state. I'm getting a county forester to come and check it out because we think it might be the biggest one. There's the passy tree in the south end, which stands in front of a daycare center. And when the kids are ready to give up their pacifier, they go outside and they have a ceremony, and it's a rite of passage. You get to tie your pacifier up, and you don't need it anymore. There's these secret espalier trees that are down on the waterfront, but they're in the condos, so this isn't public property, but I just love these because nobody knows they're there. You go up, and you turn around, and you look at the waterfront, and all, there they are. There's the Ronald McDonald sugar maple, which many of us love and maybe have or have not climbed before. And then there's this pear tree on Russell Street that I heard about the other day that's about 60 years old, and it was planted by the woman who lived in that house for a really long time, and she made friends with her neighbor who used to come over and help her pick the pears and press the pears. And she had to go to a care facility last year, and she sold her house to that neighbor who now brings the community together every year to pick the pears and press the pears and enjoy the pears together. And I stopped by and introduced myself, and he gave me the last pear. It's Carl. He's a really nice guy. So again, you know, what does this say about our city? You know, a really big part of my job, like I mentioned, is talking about the benefits of trees, and it's also convincing decision makers and planners and public works employees and roads foremen that trees are part of the infrastructure. So just like road signs and fire hydrants and streetlights and sidewalks, these are providing value, and they're actually the only kind of infrastructure that gains value over time, doesn't immediately start depreciating. So that this is something worth investment. And it's often a hard sell. And a lot of places don't get it. But I am happy to say that I think most people in Burlington get this for the most part. And I think we see that in the history of how we've cared for our urban forests and how it's cared for now and how many people are stewards of our trees. So with that, I'm gonna send you home. I want you to think about trees. Maybe if you're inspired, go outside and find a public tree in that little space between the sidewalk and the street and give it a hug and say thank you. And that's all I have to say. That's vtcommunityforestry.org is my organization's website. We do a lot of educational programming all over the place, and Branch Out Burlington's website is right there if you want to enter an awesome tree into the contest.
Another round of applause for Elise Schadler. Well, that's great. Thank you, everybody, for coming out this evening. I hope you've learned a thing or two about the green spaces in our city and how they got there and all of the wonderful stories and people that that had an influence in that. Couple of quick announcements to send you home with. One is, for those of you that have done an exit survey, thank you. For those of you that haven't yet, please consider doing one. These surveys that you heard about are a great way for us to make Burlington Geographic tailored to the things that you want to hear about. And this is a community program for all of you. We want to make it tailored to your interests. So please do one of those surveys on your way out the door. Please sign up for our field walks. Please check out our website, Burlington, uvm.edu/burlgeo, Burlgeo, for more information about all sorts of wonderful things to explore about Burlington. So I invite you to check that out. What else? Any other announcements? Well, our next program is this upcoming Monday, as Walter mentioned, October 3rd at Main Street Landing Film House above Skinny Pancake, 7 o'clock. We'll learn all about the water systems in Burlington. So if you want to know what that weird reservoir thing is that nobody seems to know about, that's your chance to learn about it. So anyway, thank you all very much. Have a great evening.